In this video, we're going to take a closer look at circular motion. Anytime an object revolves around a singular point or axis, that's circular motion. The first key property that any object moving in a circular motion possesses is called tangential velocity, represented with v with a subscript of t. Tangential velocity can be thought of as the velocity of the object as it moves with circular motion. The speed remains constant, while the direction of the object is always changing. Centripetal acceleration is also a key property of all objects that undergo uniform circular motion. Acceleration is a measure of an object's change in velocity over time. Since velocity is a vector quantity, which requires both a magnitude and direction, even an object undergoing uniform circular motion would experience centripetal acceleration due to the changing directional components of the velocity vector as the object turns. This change in velocity, the centripetal acceleration, is always directed towards the center of the circle. Centripetal acceleration of an object that is undergoing circular motion can be calculated if the tangential velocity and distance the object is from the center of the circle, or axis, is known. This distance is known as the radius. Here's the equation for calculating centripetal acceleration. A sub c equals v sub t squared, divided by the radius where centripetal acceleration is in meters per second squared, tangential velocity is in meters per second, and the radius is in meters. Here's a sample problem involving the calculation of the centripetal acceleration. As part of an experiment, a student ties her smartphone to a string and begins swinging it above her head. If the string is 0.45 meters long, and the smartphone attains an instantaneous tangential velocity of 13 meters per second, what is the centripetal acceleration of the phone? Assuming she holds her arm straight up in the air as she swings the phone. Let's write down our variables. The radius of the circle is 0.45 meters long, and the tangential velocity is 13 meters per second. Our unknown is our centripetal acceleration. Since we know the distance of the string, we can plug that into the equation for radius. The tangential velocity is also given to us, so we can plug that into the equation here. Then we square the tangential velocity, and we get 169 meters squared per second squared. Then, we divide 169 meters squared per second squared by the radius 0.45 meters, and we get 376 meters per second squared. That's the centripetal acceleration of the phone as it moves in a circular path. There's another important property to consider when investigating objects in circular motion. If the string holding the phone were to break while we were watching from above, it would look to us like the phone is flying off in a straight line. That's due to its inertia. If the string stays intact, it provides an opposing force directed towards the center of the circle that keeps the phone from flying away. We can determine the amount of force that the string provides if we consider Newton's second law, which states the net force acting on an object in newtons is equal to the object's mass in kilograms times its acceleration in meters per second squared. In this scenario, if we consider just the horizontal component of the phone in circular motion, this net force can be called the centripetal force, or F sub c, which in this example is due to the tension in the string. This force causes the phone to have centripetal acceleration, A sub c. Centripetal force equals mass times centripetal acceleration. So if the phone has a mass of 0.40 kilograms, we can use Newton's second law as it relates to circular motion to calculate this force, where we take the mass, 0.40 kilograms, and multiply that by the centripetal acceleration, 376 meters per second squared, and find that the centripetal force provided by the string that kept it in uniform circular motion was 150 kilograms times meters per second squared, or 150 newtons. There's an equation for centripetal force that you can use, which simply substitutes centripetal acceleration for acceleration in Newton's second law. It's F sub c, or centripetal force in newtons, is equal to the mass, in kilograms, of the object in circular motion, times the tangential velocity of the object in meters per second squared, divided by the radius in meters of the circle. Centripetal force is just the name we give to the class of forces acting on any object that's in uniform circular motion. The force keeping the International Space Station in orbit is gravitational force. When a race car is making a hard turn on a circular track, the friction between the tires and pavement acts as the centripetal force for the race car and driver, so it enables the car to maintain uniform circular motion. When you're on a roller coaster and are at the bottom of the loop, the normal force of the seat keeps you moving in a circle. There are many others. Any force that causes an object to move in a circle is a centripetal force. Here's a sample problem involving centripetal force. A race car driver is traveling around a circular track at a distance of 0.525 kilometers from the middle of the infield. The driver and the car have a combined mass of 885 kilograms. If the centripetal force acting on the car is 1,850 newtons, what is the car's tangential velocity? In this problem, since we are solving for the speed, we'll need to isolate that variable on one side of the equation. To do that, we would multiply both sides of the equation by the radius over the mass. This will give us the radius times centripetal force, divided by the mass, is equal to tangential velocity squared. To get the tangential velocity alone, take the square root of both sides. This makes the tangential velocity equal to the square root of the radius, times the centripetal force divided by the mass. Our radius is 0.525 kilometers. The centripetal force is 1,850 newtons, and the mass is 885 kilograms, with tangential velocity as our unknown variable. When we multiply 525 meters times 1,850 newtons, where we converted the radius to meters, we get 971,000 meters times newtons. Then we divide that by the mass, 885 kilograms, and we get the square root of 1.10 times 10 to the third. The square root of 1.10 times 10 to the third is 33.2, and that would be in meters per second. So the car is traveling at a speed of 33.2 meters per second around the track, which equals our tangential velocity. Now here's one for you to try. How fast does a satellite like the International Space Station have to move to stay in its orbit? According to Newton's second law, an object of a given mass will accelerate in the direction of the net force. For the International Space Station, traveling in a circle around the Earth, the net force acting is the gravitational force. The gravitational force acting on an object can be found by the following equation. G is called the constant of universal gravitation, and its value is 6.673. times 10 to the negative 11th newtons times meter squared per kilogram squared. If the mass of the International Space Station is 4.20 times 10 to the 5th kilograms, and the mass of the Earth is 5.97 times 10 to the 24th kilograms, and the total distance between the center of the Earth and the orbiting space station is 6.62 times 10 to the 6 meters, what is the total gravitational force acting on the International Space Station as it orbits? Go ahead and press pause, give it a try, and when you think you have an answer, come back and check your work. Did you get 3.82 times 10 to the 6 newtons? If so, great job. If not, let's take a look at the solution. If you multiply the gravitational constant times the mass of the Earth times the mass of the International Space Station, you get 1.67 times 10 to the 20th newtons times meter squared. We then need to divide that by the radius, 6.62 times 10 to the 6th squared, which is 4.38 times 10 to the 13th. And we find that the total gravitational force is 3.82 times 10 to the 6 newtons. Now that we know the centripetal force that's acting on the space station, let's see if we can calculate what tangential velocity the space station must maintain in order to stay in orbit. Use the equation we worked with earlier that had centripetal force equal to the tangential velocity squared, times the mass, divided by the radius. Remember, in this example, centripetal force is the force due to gravity. Go ahead and give it a try, and when you've finished, come back and check your work. Did you get 7,760 meters per second? If you did, nice work. If not, let's take a look at the solution. Earlier in this segment, we rearranged the centripetal force equation and isolated tangential velocity. We found that tangential velocity is equal to the square root of the product of the centripetal force times the radius divided by the mass. When we plug in our values for centripetal force, 3.82 times 10 to the 6 newtons, the radius, which was 6.62 times 10 to the 6 meters, and the mass of the space station, which was 4.20 times 10 to the 5th kilograms, and then solve, we find that the tangential velocity must be 7,762 meters per second, or 7,760 rounded to three significant figures. And that's the closer look at circular motion. For more physics in motion, go to our homepage, where the entire series is available to you.